We welcome those who worship with us in the sanctuary, those who are watching live as we're streaming on Facebook, and those listening on 96.1 on the little radio station we broadcast on. So I say hi to Catherine, who I believe is listening out in the parking lot, but she has a cold, so she's not going to expose us. But I'd like to start with announcements and welcome. Does anybody have any announcements? Billy.
Hi, we have some leftover cake and cookies all wrapped up in the
vestibule.
Yes, and please take some. It's very good cake, and I made the cookies. And also life support tomorrow night at 6 p.m. Thank you.
Billy is saying that we have cake and cookies left over from the Emmaus gathering that was here yesterday. So that's in the vestibule. If anybody wants some, they're welcome to it. Also reminding everyone that Billy has a 6 p.m. on Monday life support group that you're all welcome to go to. And I hope that that continues to be a worthwhile endeavor, which I'm sure it is. It's doing a lot of good for a lot of people. Anybody else?
Hey. Someone changed the date for soup and sandwich to next Sunday. And if that's right, we just left the same, I left the same sheet there. I don't know who changed the date, and I didn't know it until I got here. But
the
people
date
are signed up for soup and sandwiches and stuff. But they need to look to see if they still plan on bringing it next Sunday.
Judy wants to respond to that.
Hey, what we'd like to do is have it on
February 4th.
Yeah. So next Sunday is it'll be February 4th. Yeah. That's the day of our congregational meeting, and our district superintendent, Reverend Scott Harmon, will be here. And he'll be here for our meeting. He's going to do the sermon for us, and we're going to have communion. And then afterwards, that's we'd like to all gather for soup and sandwich. So is that possible? We can do it for February 4th?
So that's 2 weeks from today.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Oh, it's 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
So you want communion that same Sunday? I didn't know that either.
Well, you wouldn't have known. We just got to be able to do that. So if that's possible, that would be great.
Sorry that I know it is.
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're having soup and sandwich on February 4th. We're also going to welcome DS Scott Harmon to give the sermon and also offer communion, which we certainly welcome. And at that time, too, we also want to have a church meeting. And so this will all coincide. So we invite you and others to accompany us. Anybody else? Okay. Well, with that, why don't we ask Jane to call us to worship.
Thank you.
beautiful having that prelude every time. The music in the church just speaks to my heart. I'm sure it speaks to yours too. So at this point, if we could please call ourselves to worship. It's Psalm 62, found on page 787 of the United Methodist Hymnal. For God alone, my soul waits in silence.
For my hope is from God, who alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress, I shall not be shaken.
On God rests my deliverance and my honor, my mighty rock, my refuge is God.
Trust in God at all times, O people.
Pour out your heart
before God, who is a refuge for us.
Those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. In the balances, they go up. They are altogether lighter than a breath.
Put no confidence in extortion.
Set no vain hopes on robbery.
If riches increase, set not your heart on them.
Once God has spoken, twice have I heard this. Power belongs to God.
And to you, O Lord, belongs steadfast love, for you repay all according to your word.
Amen. And if you remain standing for the hymn on page 344, Lord, you have come to the lecture.
Now my voice left, I will show my name.
At this point, I'm going to ask for your joys and concerns. Brenda?
This morning I received a message from Jennifer Bastian. Jennifer is the daughter of Mary and Kay Harrison, who are longtime members of our church and live downstate now. But she wanted me to ask the church family and friends. Mary and Kay are celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary on the 25th next week. And she just wants to know if you might be willing to send a card to them to help them celebrate with maybe a memory or a photo of them. And so if anyone would like to do that, I have their address.
Oh, that's wonderful. Jen Erickson, Mary Eric Bastian, on July 25th, my birthday away. And Jennifer's asking for prayers and for celebration in Mary Erickson's 60th anniversary. And because it's next week, if you want to send a card, Brenda has an address. Anybody else? I'm going to say a joy of the Emmaus gathering yesterday. And also to appreciate Judy and Tomoko and all their hard work to get this system. Technology has its challenges, doesn't it? And over the course of this, we have tried to give you our services and make it available on YouTube and on our Facebook page, and it's been a challenge. But thanks to them and a large part Tomoko, we have it operational. And that way, people who can't make it into the sanctuary or who might want to, you can watch it later on Facebook. And so it's just a really joy. Judy?
Thank you, Marlene, also.
And also thanks to Marlene, because she was over here helping, and I was on the phone with them, as well as they called Pastor Mark. And so it's always a team. You know, as a team, we pull together and we can make miracles happen. So that's, anybody else?
Chuck? I guess we've mentioned everybody. Let's put her in our prayers. Catherine's health and her voice. Her voice was coming back. Caught a little something, and now it's gone again.
Yeah, we will absolutely keep Catherine in our prayers. She's been struggling with her voice issue, and now she seems to have a cough and a cold. She would be here celebrating with us, but she's close by. Hi, Catherine. Anybody else? Okay, so then I ask you to please bow your heads and pray. Dear God, we appreciate you being here with us as you always are. You are here to offer comfort and direction. There's an unspoken prayer that I want to offer, an unspoken anonymous that is not mentioned, but we feel deeply to comfort and to offer God's mercy and our love and His great love to everybody in this building, anybody listening, and for people in our town, this community, our country, and the world. We offer a joy of past members, Kay and Gary Erickson, who are celebrating next week their 60th anniversary, to Jennifer, their youngest daughter, who is preparing to help celebrate and knows that they have a connection in this church and that would be very meaningful. I offer prayers of thanksgiving for our amazing community who met here and who has leftovers for us in the form of cake and cookies in the vestibule. We thank God for Tomoko and Judy and Marlene, Pastor Mark, all those who have worked so hard to get the system up and running to where we can be better than ever and reach out beyond these doors. We offer prayers for Catherine's health, that it return and that she can return to us quickly. And all things, Lord Jesus, we offer our humble thanks and ask you to be with us as we are here in the service and then as we go out to live our life this week, knowing that you are always with us. And we give thanks as Jesus taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I'd like to ask whoever usually helps with collection so we can offer our gifts, tithes, and offerings. Thank you.
From the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth.
When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he had compassion and did not bring upon them the destruction he had threatened. The New Testament reading is 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 29 to 31. What I mean, brothers, is that time is short. From now on, those who have wives should live as if they had none. Those who mourn as if they did not. Those who are happy as if they are not. Those who buy something as if it were not theirs to keep. Those who use the things of the world as if not engrossed in them. For this world, in its present form, is passing away. Now we have special music, and I think Judy's going to help lead us.
Good, yeah. I forgot to ask anybody to help, so. All our strong singers, please help us. We're going to do a song many of you might remember from Sunday school. It's called Fishers of Men.
I've asked Ryan and Brenda to come up to the choir.
Thank you. Yeah, I need to do that before we get started.
So part of the special music is for the entire congregation to participate.
Cool. How many people remember this song?
Right.
Several of you, so that's good.
You'll catch on.
Dave, you know it? Come on up. Okay, give us an intro.
Stage left. Where's that
mark? Mark?
I never could get that straight. Catherine knows.
Okay,
I can't.
Perfect.
Stage left and right.
I've never heard of it.
Well, you haven't. Well, this is a great song from Sunday school and Bible camp and things like that. It's a great song. I will make you fishers of men. Go ahead.
I will say that's because I was not in Bible school as a child, nor Bible camp, nor Sunday school. So.
A little more.
Oh, come in, Peggy. Peggy, come on in. There you go.
We're going to get our lines tangled.
Okay, we're ready.
Jenny, okay. I'm going to count it out, and I realize, oh, it's, I don't have to count it for me.
To me, I will give you rest. And we say that several times. Okay? Here we go.
Thank you, Judy, Chuck, Brenda, Brian, Peg. and all who participate. And it was a familiar song for me when I went to Camp Mishigami. I started at the age of 7, and I went 10 years.
Wow.
So it was a big part of my life. For the gospel reading, I just wanted to make sure I was on the program here. The gospel reading is from Mark chapter 1, verses 14 through 20. If you please rise for the gospel reading. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in the boat mending their nets. Immediately he called to them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Today, I'd like us to contemplate the story of Jonah. Most of us have heard about Jonah in Sunday school. I know I did, and it might have been Ruthie Vogelein, Marilyn Paris, any number of the wonderful saints who were my Sunday school teachers right here in this church where I grew up. As a youngster, I believed that Jonah was swallowed by a whale. But today there are some scholars, even Christian scholars, who cast doubt, claiming that the story is just an Old Testament parable. To me, there's no wiggle room. The story is true, and I'm going to tell you why. Unlike other prophets in the Bible, the book of Jonah is unique, as it was not written about his prophecies. It was written about him as a person at a point in his life. First, we first learn about Jonah in 2 Kings chapter 14. It's around 785 BC. Verse 25 speaks about Jonah, son of Amittai. I worked a lot on this. Just the names alone. Being a prophet of Israel from Gath-Hepher. It's a small community near Nazareth. Earlier in the chapter, it also mentions that Jonah had the pleasant task of delivering good news, or a good report from God, that Israel should enjoy a season of peace. This made Jonah a very popular prophet in his day, delivering peace. In the scripture that Carolyn read, thank you, Carolyn, we heard that the Lord's word came to Jonah a second time. What happened the first time the Lord spoke to Jonah? I think we all know. I'm going to read from Jonah 1, verses 1 through 3. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, "Go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come before me." But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa, found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid his fare and went on board to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. He skedaddled. He tried to run away from God and the task God set before him. But why? Jonah was prideful, being a Hebrew, and believed that his nation uniquely favored God. He, like the Jews of the day, emphasized Jewish exclusivity and abhorred even the thought of salvation for the Gentiles, especially the Nevites. Pagans to him were the worst kind of human garbage. That God should take an interest in them was unthinkable. Jonah did not want them saved, so he rebelled. He was quite happy to announce safety and good times to his countrymen, but understandably somewhat grumpy and uncooperative when God commanded him to announce a message of deliverance to Israel's arch enemies, the cruel Assyrians, in their capital city of Nineveh. That fact made me think about the troubles in the Middle East today. If we were to put Jonah's story in context of today's headlines, we better understand the conflict he had. At that time, Nineveh's population was 120,000, and the largest city in the world for quite some time. Today, Nineveh is known as the city of Mosul in northern Iraq. One source estimated the trip at being 300 miles. I Googled it. If he was indeed around Nazareth, it would be 561 miles as a crow flies, but we didn't have air transportation back then. Either way, it was a long distance. But he didn't do that. He fled to Joppa, paid a fare, boarded a ship, headed to Tarshish in the exact opposite direction, away from the presence of the Lord. Now in chapter 1, verse 4, we learn that, but the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and such a mighty storm came upon the sea that the ship threatened to break apart. The mariners were afraid, each praying to their own God, and Jonah was sleeping in the belly of the ship, in the ship's hold. Some say he was even snoring. Now they're up there praying, holding on for dear life. The storm is raging and Jonah's napping. Now the captain and the crew woke him. They're praying to their gods. They want to implore him to also pray. They're all praying. And they question him. And he came clean because of him. And he implored them, he said, pick me up and throw me into the sea, then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great storm has come upon you. Now initially they didn't want to do it. They were good people. They're just not going to throw somebody overboard. And they got and they tried to row closer, but the storm raged. It got worse and worse and worse, and they were afraid the ship was going to break in two. And so again, Jonah implores them, and they did as Jonah instructed, and threw him into the sea. In verse 17, it says, but the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now that's usually where the skeptics come in. They think no one can survive for 3 days and three nights in the belly of a whale. One version of the Bible stated that Jonah was in the fish's maw. Well, I looked that up. Mm-hmm. Now a maw, does anybody know what a maw is?
Nope.
Well, it said, you know, some say mouth, but when I looked it up, it was also called a swim bladder, a gas bladder, or an air bladder. I prefer to think of it as an air bladder myself. It's an internal gas-filled organ that contributes to the ability of many bony fish to control buoyancy. Now, and we think, well, that was way back then. Well, on November 5th, 2020, in San Luis Obispo Bay, California, Sam McMillan, a photographer, snapped an amazing photo. Now, I happened to see it. I think it ran in the New York Times. It wasn't really published until 2021. I saw it fairly recently. And in that, two kayakers in a tandem kayak were lifted out there. They lifted out of the water in the mouth of a breaching humpback. Immediately, in seeing this picture, it was amazing. It was just, and the kayakers, one in front was kind of up and had the paddle up, and the other one was a little further deep, and immediately I thought of Jonah. Now that story goes on, and I saw the video on it, but that's another story. More recently, in June 2021, Michael Packard, he was a lobster scuba diver in Massachusetts, and he went for a dive around Cape Cod. He went down, and when he was about 10 feet from the bottom, he was swallowed by a giant humpback whale. He said it was, quote, felt like being hit by a train. Once trapped inside the whale's mouth, he thought he would die. He said, I thought about my kids and my wife. Fortunately, he had a breathing device. He pushed and pounded on the mouth, on the teeth, in desperation. And then, as a mammal started going to the surface, it began furiously shaking its head. And this is a quote. And then boom, he said, I fly out of its mouth and I'm like, oh my God. Now back in 1891, it was reported that a seaman was swallowed by a large sperm whale near the Falkland Islands. After 3 days, he was recovered, unconscious but alive, with some skin damage. Amazing. So Jonah is in the belly or air bladder of a sea creature. What does he do? He prays. I would be praying, right? Wouldn't we all be praying? Actually, Jonah composed a song of thanksgiving. I'm going to read that for you. I called to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cry, and you heard my voice. You cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight. How shall I look again upon your holy temple? The water closed in over me. The deep surrounds me. Weeds were wrapped around my head at the root of the mountains. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought up my life from the pit. O Lord my God. As my life was ebbing away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who worship vain idols forsake their true loyalty, but I, with a voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What have I vowed, I will pay. What I have vowed, I will pay. Deliverance belongs to the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to the fish, and it spewed Jonah out upon the dry land. God forgives Jonah. He speaks to the fish, and the fish vomits up Jonah on what was probably the shores of the Mediterranean. God saved and forgave Jonah and provided transportation. Very close to his destination. There is truly nothing that our God cannot do. According to researchers, ancient cave drawings from that time period indicated that the Nevatite fishermen lived on the shores of the Mediterranean. This fact is important to illustrate the wonderful way in which God paves the way for his servants to fulfill his commands. In those days, the Nevatites worshipped a sea god named Dagon, who had man's upper body and a fish's tail. Dagon was worshipped by the Sumerians, the Phoenicians, and was regarded as, quote, father of gods. He also was worshipped further east in Mesopotamia, where many rulers regarded him as the god capable of granting them kingship over the western area, which would include Israel. Researchers claim that Jonah's body would have been bleached white from the acids in the belly of the fish. On this sudden appearance of Jonah's ghostly figure from the sea, fishermen may have been convinced that he was Dagon's messenger. The fishermen would have lifted Jonah up, fed, nursed him, and helped him prepare for his mission. Jonah's story is verified by Jesus in both Luke and Matthew. I'm going to read Matthew 12, 38 through 41. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you. But he answered them, An evil and adulterous generation asks for no sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a sea monster, so for 3 days and 3 nights the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth. The people of Nevia will rise up at the judgment with his generation and condemn it, because they repented at the proclamation of Jonah, and see, something greater than Jonah is here. As Carolyn read, Jonah completed his mission. He eventually did what God commanded, but he was not happy about it. Jonah walked one full day into the crowded city of 120,000, the largest city in the world at the time, a city that it takes 3 days to walk across. He delivers God's message only one time. He cries out these 9 words, just 40 days more and Nevia will be overthrown. That's it. He did what God asked, nothing more. He was still very angry. He didn't want to do it. He didn't see them differently. They were his enemies. He did it for God, but he was against it all the way. Hoping that they won't repent, Jonah goes to a place to watch the city be destroyed. And when God saw how the people stopped their evil ways, he forgave them. Well, Jonah is furious. Jonah argues with God, says, well, this is why I fled. Now you see why I fled. I knew you were a good God. I knew you were going to forgive them. I knew you would be understanding. But he was not. But God is. Jonah is not to be consoled, continues complaining to God, but God chastises him for his attitude and tries to teach him that God's mercy extends even to the inhabitants of a hated foreign city. I ask you, how far does God's mercy extend? It has no end. It has no end. Think about Jonah's reluctance compared to Simon and Andrew, James and John. Jesus said, come follow me, I will make you fishers of men. They dropped their nets, and James and John left their father with the servants. They immediately left and followed Jesus. Why does it take us sometimes so long? We are each fighting our own prejudices and attitude. We are not God. We are sinners. We try to do the best we can, but we come here to be more like Jesus, more like God. That particular message in Mark appears shortly after Jesus is baptized. Remember when John baptizes Jesus and there's a dove? The heavens open up and the Spirit descends as a dove. Interesting to know, Jonah in Hebrew is Yoneh. It means dove. One writing from a historian describes Jonah as follows, quote, and I'm quoting, "Proud, stubborn, disobedient, unfaithful, a grumbler, and an altogether bad-tempered, cantankerous old curmudgeon," unquote. He has a reputation. But we also learned that Jonah was courageous. Telling sailors to throw him into the sea just so they could be saved displayed his bravery and his ability to be compassionate. Jonah was human with all our human frailties, and God, like a loving parent, tries to help him understand. Jonah always turns back to God, and God is forgiven. Did Jonah ever get it? You know, you look at, and even in Moses, when God challenged Moses to go, he was going, "Yeah, my brother Aaron, he speaks a lot better than I can. He can do this." You know, what God asks us to do is not always easy. But we have to take steps toward it, right? Only 48 verses in the four chapters of Jonah. 48 verses. And yet, it is a powerful book in the Bible and elsewhere. The story of Jonah is recorded in Christianity, but also in Judaism, in Islam, and in the Baha'i faith. There's a feast celebrated on September 21st in Catholicism. I wonder if they serve fish. No? Okay. So that is Jonah. A great comfort to all that fall flat at times when it comes to obedience and who run away from what they know God wants them to do. Jonah's story is also a lesson to those who are possessed of a short fuse and those guilty of superior attitudes to the spiritually ignorant or immature. From Jonah we learn that God's mercy is extended to all. Even those who we think are undeserving and those who we may judge to be unworthy. But we are not the judge. You cannot hide from God. Number three, you cannot rush God. Jonah wanted God to dole out punishment on his clock instead of according to God's plan. Number four, everyone deserves compassion. The story teaches us about repentance to God for forgiveness and by following God's word, forgiveness is received. Number five, God's love can change people. It can and it does every day. Like the Nevites, many are in darkness, and but by the grace of God, so would we be. May we all, by that grace, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest the Word of God. Would you pray with me, please? Dear Lord, as God had patience with Jonah and provided a right to him to help him on his mission, so have patience with us as we listen to your voice. Let our path be straight when we strive to do your good work. Let us remember the enormity of your forgiveness and let your love continue to change us for the better. Amen. And our closing hymn is Here I Am, Lord, on page 593 of the United Methodist Hymnal.
Thank you. Yeah.